On today's episode of After Hours with Bleck and Abdalla, a new mock draft has the Bears taking Caleb Williams first overall and Roma Dunze to the Bears.
Ooh, it's going to be a good draft for the Bears if it shakes out that way.
What would you order if you went out to dinner with Caleb Williams the first time he's in town? Abdalla has his list. It's a great list.
I'm all about the flow of the dinner. I don't want to disrupt the flow. So I got to maybe I'll order this, maybe I'll order that.
A 5-on-5 hockey fight? We'll get into that as well. And I saw a ridiculous item on the train being moved. Think about it. From your house, moving it on the train. It's crazy. That's all coming up. Make sure you like and subscribe to the page. It's Bleck and Abdalla After Hours. You can also download the podcast on the ESPN Chicago app. After Hours starts now. Let's start with this. Field Yates has his new mock draft out on ESPN.com, Abdalla. And when we look at it, three quarterbacks go 1, 2, 3 at the top of the board. Something we've kind of talked about. Yeah. Caleb Williams goes to the Bears first. But there's a lot of different pieces of this. J.J. McCarthy, where does he land? And who do the Bears take with the 9th pick?
Well, I think this shakes out well, right? As long as four quarterbacks go before the Bears pick, which they do, it looks like that they're going to have their choice of a wide receiver, edge rusher, all that good stuff. So I think the way Field Yates has this working out, this works out the best for the Bears situation here.
Yeah, it's Roma Dunze. Yeah. If Roma Dunze is there for the Bears at 9, I think we all kind of agree that that's going to be the best situation. You know, Roma Dunze was in town today. We're taping this on a Thursday. Yesterday, Caleb Williams was in town. So if you match Caleb Williams with Roma Dunze, I think Bears fans are going to look at this as an A-plus draft. Like if you leave day one of the draft with Roma Dunze and Caleb Williams, that's an A-plus move for the Bears organization.
Absolutely. But also, I think the Bears are in the perfect spot at number 9, too, because if it doesn't work out that way and Adunze is not there, you're still left with Dallas Turner. You're still left with Jared Verse. You have a chance to do what the Texans did last year, take the best offensive player as your quarterback and take the best defensive player at Dallas Turner to shore up that edge on the other side of Montez Sweat. So either way, this is best case scenario for the Bears. Having your choice of wide receiver, having your choice of edge rusher, whatever it's going to be, this is the best case scenario for the Bears.
What do you think about the top three quarterbacks going 1, 2, 3, Caleb first, and then with Drake May and Jaden Daniels? Those have been the two that have been rumored to be that high on the board for a long time, especially in this draft process. And then where does J.J. McCarthy land? Field says it's a little bit later, but some people are saying that McCarthy would go 4th and that he could really rise on these draft boards.
I think that teams are going to start to get desperate. We've seen the J.J. McCarthy hype kind of continue to go up on this like roller coaster that we've been riding with him. You know, if he wasn't, I don't think he's worth the 4th overall pick, but I think that he's going to go in the top 10. I think he's going to go somewhere before the Bears pick. I like Drake May before Jaden Daniels. I think to me, it's Caleb Williams at the very, very top. And then you drop a little bit. It's Drake May, Jaden Daniels right there. And then I would drop a little bit more. And that's where I find J.J. McCarthy. I just don't think J.J. McCarthy was proven. Now, I said the exact same thing about Justin Herbert when he was at Oregon and then ended up going and being drafted by the Chargers. Said the exact same thing. Doesn't throw a lot in the offense. They really don't use him. They're more of a run first team at Oregon. And then he goes to the Chargers and he starts lighting it up. So I could be wrong again on J.J. McCarthy, the same way I was wrong about Justin Herbert. But what I've seen from J.J. McCarthy and the way that they used him at Michigan, I don't know if he's worthy of a top 5 pick, but I think he's going to be a top 5 pick.
Okay, let's get into this though. Were we fooled by Justin Herbert? I'm not sure if we were. Like we were wrong in the draft analysis and what he did at Oregon coming into the draft. But I don't recall Justin Herbert flying up draft boards the way that J.J. McCarthy has. Like, I feel like Herbert had a ceiling that people thought like this is where he should go. And that's what it was the entire draft process. J.J. McCarthy has been a totally different story. You know, like the games ended. And then, boom, here comes J.J. flying up draft boards. I think that's a little different. It has a different feel. So you're right. The way he played in college reminds me of a quarterback that perhaps the team he played on didn't use his talents exactly to showcase everything he can do. But then again, they were really good. They were a run-first team in the Big Ten.
Yeah.
They didn't allow it, but they won football games. and they were very successful. They win the national championship at Michigan. I don't know. I feel like the assessment on McCarthy is right. I feel like the Herbert stuff was, we were wrong because he was used incorrectly. I kind of feel like the reason Michigan had McCarthy not throw the football is because he can't necessarily throw the football like some of these other quarterbacks in this draft class.
No, that's fine. So you hear that. We were not wrong about...
We were wrong Justin a Herbert. Little.
No. We were wrong. Not wrong. Oregon was wrong. That's who was wrong. This is on you, Oregon.
Place the blame on the Ducks.
This is on
always.
You. On
always.
You.
It's not our problem. All right, let's move on to this. So Caleb Williams in town this week with the Chicago Bears. It's part of the 30 visit where he got a chance to be at Hallis Hall. The Bears also wined and dined Caleb Williams, and reports came out that he was at Sophia Steak in Lake Forest.
Ooh,
yeah, a fancy joint, Abdalla. Fancy. And this is why we wanted to get into it. So they were up in Lake Forest. They go to Sophia Steak. First date. Now, they met in Los Angeles.
Yeah.
So not technically the first date.
No,
but that's
the meet cute.
Yeah. So I want to get into this because I want to ask you this. If you were there with Caleb Williams the first time he's in town going to dinner,
okay,
what would you order off the menu?
Okay. So if I'm looking at the menu here, I am a big fan of grilled octopus. Okay. Love a grilled octopus. Everybody goes with calamari. If I see calamari and I see grilled octopus on the menu, I'm going with grilled octopus. I feel like that's also good for the table. You get to see how adventurous he is. We know he can operate out of the pocket, but was he willing to try weird food? I feel like grilled octopus, a little bit of weird food. So I'm going to start with a little grilled octopus for the table, see how everybody does with that, okay? Then this is a judgment call here. I sit this one out, and I wait to see if everybody else orders a salad. If everybody else orders a salad, I feel like if I'm getting a grilled octopus, if I'm getting a steak, if I'm getting a side, the salad's going to be a little bit of filler. But if I see that everybody else is getting a salad, I'm going to go with Bill's Classic Caesar Salad. That's what's on the menu.
Yes.
Bill's Classic Caesar Salad on the menu. Going to get that. Then for my main course, I'm going to get the Black Angus Filet. Love a good filet. Okay. I'm going to get the Black Angus Filet, cooked medium. And for my side, crispy potato hash. Everybody else is going to go mashed potatoes. Everybody else is going to go maybe an asparagus or a grilled broccoli or something like that. I'm going to zig when everybody's zagging. I'm going to get the crispy potato hash.
I see. Here's my assessment on your order. First of all, be a man. Order your salad if you want a salad.
No.
Tiptoe around waiting to see if others
need it.
But you're going to have FOMO if other people order a salad.
No, I'm just going to be like,
if you want the salad, go right for the salad. Order what you want.
But I don't want to disrupt the flow of the dinner.
Well, you're not. It's the restaurant's job to figure out the flow of the dinner. It's not your job to figure out the flow.
I'm a team player, Chris. I'm a team player.
First of all, the double cut bacon looks awesome.
Okay, well, I don't eat bacon.
That's fine. The crab cake looks great. Okay. I'm looking at the menu right here.
Yeah.
You're right. A salad. So this is a decision you have to make. In this situation, do you go soup or salad?
Hmm.
You know, I was out at dinner the other night. I went soup. Everyone else got a salad. I was not worried about the flow of the dinner.
But you got an appetizer. Everybody else got an appetizer. I'm going to be like, I'm going to get a salad. Everybody was like, I don't want a salad.
Not necessarily.
Like, well, then I'm going to be the only one sitting here eating. Everyone's staring at me eat.
I've gone before and only ordered a soup. Like others are not ordering. You and I did this a couple weeks ago.
Know.
We were at a Mexican restaurant.
Yeah.
And I'm the only one that ordered an app. I ordered a soup for myself.
Tortilla soup.
That's it.
Yeah.
It was delicious.
I'm sure it was.
You know why? Because I wasn't worried. I didn't have FOMO or I wasn't concerned with what other people think.
It's not about that. It's being a team player. All right. It's wanting everybody to be on the same page.
Would you split the tomahawk ribeye with me for $151?
Order your own food. I'm getting the filet.
Do you think Caleb Williams would split the tomahawk
you
with
think
me?
Him and Dallas Turner split the tomahawk yesterday?
Maybe they did. No, it's a steakhouse, all right? Sophia Steak. It
of
looks
course.
Good.
I
it
get
looks
it.
Really
yeah,
good.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you have any, for those who are out there that are maybe on the dating scene, do you have any tips for a first date for guys out there?
Yes, I do.
you were prepared for
this. I was
this.
Prepared for this. It basically only comes down to when you're ordering food. I don't think that spaghetti is good date food. Nobody looks good eating spaghetti. What are you going to twirl it with your little fork?
Who is ordering spaghetti?
You're going to do the little slurp.
First date. What is wrong with you?
A lot of people go to Italian restaurants for their first date. It's a very romantic vibe. What are you talking about?
That's terrible.
So don't order spaghetti. You don't want to be like slurping up noodles into your mouth while you're trying to talk to her. It's got sauce all over your face. Gross. Don't. I would say avoid Italian for first dates altogether. Go somewhere and go to a steakhouse, maybe go to a little seafood place somewhere where, what are you going to eat a whole lasagna? And then guess what? If you don't finish the whole thing, what are you going to do? I don't want to be doing that. I don't want to be taking stuff home on a first date. That's bad etiquette, I think.
Well, step one, which you missed, eat light.
Oh yeah, of course.
You got to be light on your feet. You got to be ready to go.
That's why I'm not going to Italian.
First date, you got light on your feet. That's step one. Step two, I actually thought Italian would be okay. Just get something lighter on the Italian menu. Because okay. I think pasta allows you to be neat with the way you eat. You don't want a burger and have it slopped all over you. Mm-mm. And you look like a child if you're ordering a burger on a first date.
Burger and fries, please. And she'll have the chicken tenders.
Yeah, like you want something that seems like you're not, you know, ordering off the kids' menu.
No,
No grilled cheese. You're right. No chicken fingers. Nothing of the sorts. So there you go. Caleb Williams out at dinner the other night. With the Chicago Bears, Sophia Steak, we picked off the menu, and those are our tips if you have a first date. Let's get to this. Did you see this last night in the NHL? The Rangers and the Devils started their game with a 5-on-5 fist fight.
Yeah, old school fight. This goes back to March. There was some bad blood between these two teams back in early March, and they met again last night, and they just dropped the puck. Throwing the gloves down. It's ready to go. I love the two guys that were like, nah, we might fight. Nope. Okay. We're going to fight.
Let's get after it. Let's do it.
Eight players were ejected, four on each team. So the teams had to play four guys down each for the rest of the game because of this fight that's happened 2 seconds into the game. It was awesome. I love old school hockey fighting like this. Like, look at that. Going after it. I love it.
Yeah, I don't have a problem with the old school vibe, the fighting. Obviously, it's something that happens in hockey that, like, it's a part of the culture. I also like that the rivalry, it's carried over from other games.
Yeah.
Like, that's fun.
Yes.
I like that. There's too much in today's sports culture. There's too much of everyone getting along because we all played on AAU teams together when we were kids.
Yeah.
And you can't diss someone else. Like, I like villains and I like rivalries and I like when people are willing to fight. That's good.
My only criticism is that I don't believe the goalies fought. Like, I need
a good goalie fight is always fun.
You guys, the rest of the fighters need to know to clear out the center ice so those goalies can meet in the middle and drop gloves. The goalies are walking or skating around, they're picking up the skates and the gloves and the helmets that the players have dropped for the fight. I need a good goalie fight to go along with the rest of the skaters that are fighting.
I'm always curious. I'm like, the goalie when they face off against like a position player. Mm-hmm. Because the goalie has so much more padding.
Yeah.
Like, that's not a fair fight. So you're right. That's when the goalies have to duel against each other. Let's finish with this. Earlier today, I was on the CTA. I was on the blue line here in Chicago. And as I was walking to the platform and waiting for my train, I saw this. There is an individual who is there moving his TV on the train.
Yeah.
Now, you can see it's saran wrapped.
Which I don't know what.
Well, it was raining today. It was raining.
Okay. So I thought it was to keep it from being like scratched.
He wrapped the TV, but he's sitting there and he's moving his TV on the train. Mm-hmm. He's waiting for the train. Now, come on, buddy. You have to call Uber, right? Like, you have to fire up the rideshare app.
Yeah.
Don't move your TV. That's a big TV on the train.
But it doesn't look like cumbersome enough to not fit into the trunk of an Uber. So maybe he thought, you know, maybe I don't need the... I mean, listen, it's a blue line. I don't think he was going to O'Hare with that, trying to check a TV.
He was actually waiting on the side that was heading towards O'Hare.
Maybe he was trying to check a TV.
You can't check a TV. And I also, with Uber, you can just get the bigger car.
Yeah, you can get the SUV. Whatever.
So what's the hold up there?
Well, what's the weirdest thing you've seen being moved on a CTA train?
The besides product?
Well, yeah. Besides product in the shell game.
Well, the shell game's always fun because when you win They don't want to let you in.
No, they don't want to let you in.
So the PSA to all the kids out there is don't play the shell game.
Don't play the shell game.
If you're on a train in the city of Chicago. the weirdest thing that I've seen on the CTA being moved, I feel like this TV is the top of my list.
Christmas tree.
A Christmas tree?
Christmas tree.
Before Christmas, someone bought one.
Bought one from on a lot and took it on the red line and then transferred to the brown line. And then that's where I saw them on the red line. And then I got off the red line and I saw them walking up the stairs to the brown line.
I don't think that that's that weird. You know why? Because the value of a tree, if you lose a limb, if some needles fall off, it's not a big deal. If you damage your TV,
you're screwed.
You're out a lot of money.
You're out of TV.
Right? Like,
I don't know. Trees are pretty expensive these days. Like a real tree,
it's
close to $100 these days.
But you can be rough with it a little.
Yeah.
Like, it's okay.
But if you're
getting... It's annoying for the other people on the train.
If you're getting a fake or a real tree and you have to transport it on multiple trains, just order a fake tree off of Amazon and keep it in your house year-round. Just store it away somewhere so you don't have to do this every single year. I gotta take two trains to go to the lot to get a tree to come back out.
Yes.
No.
Yes.
Not for me.
Thank you for watching After Hours with Bleck and Abdalla. Make sure you like and subscribe the page. You can also download the podcast on the ESPN Chicago app. We'll talk to you later.